Okay, we are officially now starting session two, although this is the third time we're meeting since the start of the Freestyle Plus series, and I'm glad to have you all here, and I hope that last week, although very full of information, the information, as you maybe read through the two chapters, the introduction in chapter one, you were able to find some clarity. And if you weren't able to find some clarity, that's what we're going to address at the end of this session today in the Q&A portion, which I'm going to try to get to 10 minutes before the official end. Now, for those of you who have to leave, just a friendly reminder to leave your comments in the chat, and that way I can maybe find them and answer whatever concerns are coming up. If you have a very specific question, like Campbell was sharing here, I would love to be able to dive into that as well and potentially continue to address the answer to those questions as we go through the 6 weeks together. Now, let me just share what we have in store for today, which starts with the topic of movement ability, which is officially our chapter two. And this chapter two, I open with Bruce Lee's quote, which is, when you want to move, you're moving. And this is the key or cornerstone for movement, which is this notion that when we want to access it, when we need to access it, it's there for us. And this is where intention comes into play, purpose comes into play, and where we are able to express our performance at the highest level is when we can translate our intention, our purpose, physically, and express it throughout our behavior in this world. So that's something to keep in mind as we're going through this chapter, is that movement ability is really our capacity to translate that which is inside to that which we are experiencing outside. And in this chapter, I open up by sharing a tiered system approach for looking at our movement in the world. And the first tier or level is the one of health, wellness, or well-being. That is simply the tier of being alive. You are alive right now, and everything is working well enough to allow you to not die. That's basically our tier one. Now, you may think that that is very maybe negative or very limited, but it's how we actually operate as human beings. We are constantly looking for that which is the minimum effort, the minimum amount of energy, the minimum amount of thought to simply exist. And this is how most of the health system is built. In fact, we have been really become aware of this over the last 2 years with the pandemic. It's the art of minimal effort for simple survival. And this is where there is a disconnect between what it means to be alive and feel alive. Right now, we are, as a society, simply being alive. We are surviving. But I think if you are here, you are connected with the sense, the feeling of being alive. And this translates into that which we discussed last week, which is performance measured by feel, which is that which is right in your head, logical, that which is alive in you, in your passion, in your heart, and then that which is alive in your gut, which is your body, your nervous system. So this is where tier two comes into play, which is fitness, and fitness being the expression of our current level of health. And fitness, as all of you here know, is something that happens contextually. And I'm looking at Campbell right now. He's at Deuce Gym. So his current state of fitness or context of fitness, where he is at this moment, is one where health, wellness, well-being is being challenged, pushed to the edges in order to not only be in a state of survival, but in a state where one is starting to thrive, grow, push a little further, expand. And when it comes to fitness, there are an infinite number of ways that we can approach it. And that's why, in order to find our way, we need to go back to our first session together, which was the one of identifying purpose. And the way that we have in some way identified purpose here together was in establishing what the title of our book would be. So remember that and keep that in mind as I go through this chapter of movement ability. And then finally, we have athletics or sport. And athletics or sport is kind of the tip of the iceberg. It's the one choice. It's the one point of performance that we choose to express our fitness in. And this is something that if we get a little philosophical, we can think about as every moment, that one choice, that one point of performance can be every moment that we live throughout a day, a week, a month, a year. Or it can be as simple as our sport or art or craft of choice. So if you're a dancer and you have a particular style of dance, that would be your choice. If you are in the fitness world and you are choosing CrossFit, then it would be CrossFit itself. If you're choosing within a practice of fitness, a modality such as kettlebells, like Marshall was mentioning earlier, then that would be your point of performance, your choice of performance. And this third tier is the tip of that pyramid. So at the bottom, we have health, wellness. You're just alive. What does that look like for you? Then you have fitness, which is challenging your health, trying to expand it. And then finally, you have your ultimate expression, which is your point of performance or your sport of choice. Now, in the book here, I share a story about a friend who is a gymnast that I grew up with. And I recommend that you read this story a little bit because it has to do with the simplicity that exists within the pursuit of movement ability. And sometimes we get confused between that which is sport, that which is peak performance, and that which is basic health and how it can be addressed through fitness. So I just recommend that you read that little story on your own throughout this week. And it's a simple story about how making corrections for high-level athletes sometimes doesn't require you to know anything about the sport, but rather about human performance, basic movement practices. So I recommend that you read it, and we can discuss that in a future session. And it leads to this quote that I've used since the beginning of my coaching career, which is that I don't care what you do as long as you know why you are doing it. And this is why purpose, once again, is so important. Because purpose, your why, as Simon Sinek would say, your why is that which defines how you do things and for whom you do things. And that's why I personally am not concerned with what you're doing, but rather why you're doing it. Another quote that I tend to share in my seminars, which I've said here before, I believe now in these two sessions, and if I haven't said it, I'll repeat it again. If I have said it, it's always a good reminder, is that I tell my students that I don't care about their problems. And the reason I don't care about their problems is because I have enough of my own. I'm overwhelmed with my problems. But I do care about what you intend to do about your problems. And that's why I'm here. We all have our baggage. We all have our goals. We all have our tools. So the question here is not what we have, but how we're going to work with it. So I want you to think about that as we go through this conversation that may get a little bit more technical now, as you can see. when it comes to movement ability. And when it comes to movement ability, which is simply our ability to express ourselves physically in the world, there are two main focuses. One is our form, meaning what it looks like as we express ourselves, and two is our control. And this is kind of like thinking about it from the perspective of having a ship going on a cruise, and the form is simply the ship cruising along. The control is how well one is able to choose a destination and stay on course. When it comes to movement, physical movement here, our form is going to be our physical shape, the shape that we adopt while performing. And our control is going to be our connection to how we are expressing ourselves. In other words, if you're doing something as simple as a push-up, your form is how it looks when you're executing the push-up, and your control is how well you are engaged, connected with that movement. And this is something that is hard to measure. It can be measured, but is easy to spot, easy to see. And this is something that you probably notice when you see a top-level athlete. You watch them and you are in awe when you see the best in the world perform. There's something about it that is seamless. It is fluid. It is efficient. You don't maybe know exactly why it's efficient or effective, but you can sense it. You can feel it. So when it comes to movement control, it is really important that we become aware of the feeling that comes from viewing a performance, observing a performance. And remember that we talked about observation and description last week. So when you are observing and describing your movement ability, or if you're a coach, somebody else's movement ability, think about what it is that you are sensing when you are observing the performance. This sense is going to be the first anchor for being able to communicate that which you want to see change. And this can be that which accesses or gives us access to the control, a new level of control. And when we're talking about movement control here in this chapter, I want to start by addressing the nervous system. The nervous system is the electrical system. It's that which connects our brain to the rest of the body. And I want you to remember that a lot of that which I'm sharing in part one of this book can be broken down into so many different subjects that can have 10, 20, 30 books written about each part, that everything that we're doing here is we're just trying to paint a little picture. So when we're talking about movement control, I also want you to, when thinking about the body, to start by addressing movement control from the nervous system. And from the nervous system, what we want to think about is starting from our central nervous system and then working into our peripheral system. And the way that I depict that in the book is the central nervous system is always going to show up in red, as you can see in sticks right here. And the peripheral nervous system is going to show up in the freestyle blue, this little teal color. And why is it important to keep in mind what is happening at the core and at the extremities? Well, because at the core is where we develop movement control, and it's at the extremities in the peripheral nervous system where we start to express ourselves in very unique ways. So this is something that is going to carry over into developing progressions, which, as I've addressed in chapter one in the introduction and the first day that we were hanging out, is that we're here to try to develop progressions, adaptations, roadmaps that are going to get us where we want to go. And movement control is the anchor for starting to think about progressions. And in order to think about progressions from a purely mechanical perspective, we have to start with basic shapes. And these basic shapes start with standing, as you can see here with me on the right hand side. And it's something that I try to depict with the cover art of the book. If you look at the cover of Freestyle, you see that it has different shapes on it. These very simple shapes that are lines, simple angles, and a quarter of a circle. These basic shapes are the shapes that I want us to learn how to identify in any movement that we are observing. And to notice that in these basic shapes, we are looking for two things. We are looking for form. What does the body look like? And we're looking for control. How well is the body moving in and out of these shapes? And this is where I've highlighted this little paragraph here, which is that the beauty of the human body is that it isn't limited to one plane of motion or movement. It is capable of any combination of these, which gives you an unlimited number of movement and position options. This concept should get you excited because it's your first glance into the world of freestyle. In other words, when we're looking at body shapes, we need to also acknowledge that there are an infinite number of body shapes that we can go through. But in order for our brains to compartmentalize this infinite number of possibilities, we need to start to organize them. And one of the most simple ways of organizing them is by looking at the body and looking about how we express ourselves throughout a regular day. And one of those expressions are in standing. Now, if you look at the picture of me standing there, it looks like a mugshot, but with me in an anatomical body position. This is an exaggeration of reality, but that will be our starting point. The anatomical position. And this anatomical position is something that I use to teach blocking movement, which is something I'm going to address next week as a preface for the handstand push-up progressions and the techniques within them. But I want you to start with that shape, this anatomical position in a standing position. And now I want you to imagine this anatomical position being taken to the ground, specifically to a supinated position, a position where you're lying down facing up. And from this position, this supinated position, this lying on your back position in an anatomical position, I want us to now start to think about how we would begin to move from there. And in order to do this, I want you to think about your days. You have a time of your day when you're awake. That's the time where you're standing. And then you have a time of your day where you're sleeping. That's the time when you're lying down. So I want you to notice that as I address these different body shapes and I talk about a different movement progressions, that they're all they all exist within our daily lives, regardless of how we choose to express ourselves, whether it's athletically or simply going to work and coming back home or playing with our kids. Whatever it may be, these body shapes are universal and they're present. And the most simple one is the standing. It's the one that we're so used to looking at all day when you're in an awakened state. And then the one that you get into at night, which is when you go to bed. Now, in gymnastics, you probably heard of the hollow body position. Now, the hollow body position is kind of our first tool for challenging this neutral shape, which is in standing or lying down. And you've probably seen what the hollow body position looks like. It looks like this figure four right here, or the figure five right here on the right-hand side of the book. And this one, what it really is a way of challenging our central nervous system from the spine. And as you can see here on the right-hand side of the book right now, at the top, there's a little graph there. There's the hollow body shape, which is that concave shape. expressed from a perspective of looking up into the sky, that's supinated, and then one facing down. Now, this hollow body position is not necessarily a technique. It's simply a starting place for understanding how we create stability. And how we create stability is dependent on our environment, which means that if I am facing up, if I'm lying down on the ground and facing up, the forces on my spine are going to be different than if I am facing down, than if I were in a prone position. And that's kind of what I'm demonstrating in this little graph here, which if you actually read through the text, it will all make sense to you. And if it doesn't make sense, that's why we have the Q&A. But how does it affect us different? Well, it affects us different because we, our bodies in real life, don't look like sticks. They don't look like the stick figure. Our spine is not a straight line. It's a naturally curved line. We have the cervical spine, which is the neck. We have the thoracic spine, which is the upper back. And then we have our lumbar spine, which is our lower back. And these curves, depending on where, what direction they're facing, will experience gravity from a different, will have to challenge gravity from a different point of view. And that's why this hollow body position is a great way of starting to address how we're going to challenge these shapes, specifically the most neutral shape, which expresses itself in standing or lying down and is exaggerated in the anatomical position. Now, if anybody here has studied anatomy, you know that one of the fathers of anatomy was Leonardo da Vinci. And Leonardo da Vinci established that the anatomical body position is the position that allows us to best study not only the structure of the body, but how it would potentially move. And this is something that is fascinating because that's what we're doing with any practice that we choose. So if you choose gymnastics, what you're really trying to do is establish what is our body? What do we have at our disposal to work with? And then how do we want to mold it to create that which we want or desire or need? And in that creation of what we desire and need, we are using, as I mentioned in the beginning, two aspects, which are form and control. And that's what we are observing. So through the hollow body position, what we're going to think about here as you read about this week is that we're not trying to establish the right form for a technique, but rather learning to feel what it's like to load up the spine. And why do we care about loading up the spine? Well, because when we are, for example, in a standing position, our spine is in alignment with the line of gravity. So gravity is pulling us down or pushing us down, depending on how you look at it. We're technically falling down towards the center of the earth. And as we are standing, our spine is stacked as a pillar that is in the same line as the pull of gravity. And in order for us to maximize our stability, our form, our control, we must learn how to position each vertebra, each little bone in the spine in a way that allows us to use minimal effort. When we are lying down, which is the position that we get into when we're about to fall asleep. In this position, now we are perpendicular to the line of gravity. And if you think about it from this perspective, what you will start to notice is that in that lying down position, in that supinated or prone position, the effort you have to make to stack the spine, meaning to put yourself in a neutral shape, and to find stability, to maintain the form of lying down, is even less than when you're standing. Can everybody see that? Can everybody see that standing up requires more effort than lying down? Just raise your hand so I know that you're with me. Fantastic. You're with me. The reason we're going to start with the hollow body position is because we're looking for the position that looks that requires minimal effort, such as lying down, and then starting to add some stress on it, starting to challenge it from there. Why do we care about doing it from this place? Well, we care about doing this from this place because we're trying to create the most inclusive, the most accessible starting ground. Why is this important when we're thinking about freestyle? Well, because freestyle is our ability to see all styles, all ways, all options. And the best way to capture all styles, all ways, all options is starting from the point of most inclusivity. The place of greatest inclusivity is the place where we can get access to all the progressions that are not only in existence in terms of what we know, but also the ones that we can create. So it's all about inclusivity. It's all about trying to capture as many options as possible. Now, the hollow body position, as you can see here in the figure 5, is simply a shape that is concave that kind of matches, if you look at the shape right here, this top shape. And the reason we want to start here is because this position right here is a position that is not only establishing tension around the spine, but also addressing one of the most important progression principles, which is the principle of pushing. And here, you may wonder, where am I pushing? Well, one thing that I'm doing is, in order to push my toes and my hands up off the ground, that's what I'm doing. I'm pushing my toes up and away from the ground. I have to also push my spine into the ground. Now, some of you may be thinking right now and remembering something that we talked about last week, which was pulling being the one of moving towards and pushing the one of moving away, and starting to wonder if that same concept applies to the hollow body shape. And in this case, for now, I want you to try to separate those two, as the concept of pushing and pulling that we talked about in chapter 1 was more in regards to the local lens, which was the one of joints. And this one is the one of global, a global lens, the one of the whole body, the entire shape. And I want you to remember that when we were talking about global perspectives, we were talking about skill. When we were talking about local lenses or local perspectives, the ones at the joints, we were talking about strength. I know that this is a lot of information right now, so if it feels very convoluted and it's getting mixed up, nothing to worry about, because as you read through this, it will all start to fall into the different compartments. For now, all I want you to see is that we're challenging the standing or lying down position through the hollow body position, and we're doing it by beginning to push. And the push is happening, as you can see, by bringing our hips, our bellies down, and by pushing our hands, shoulders, and feet away from the ground. And an example that I set for explaining why we're thinking about it from a pushing perspective is because when we are addressing progressions, pushing comes before pulling. And just a funny example that I try to present for those who work with the material freestyle is, if you were to run out of gas, or your car were to run out of gas, what would you do? Would you push the car to the gas station, or would you pull it? And then you may say, well, if I didn't have a tow truck, I would push it. But if I had a tow truck, I would probably pull it. If you had a tow truck, if you were the tow truck, when you are applying force into the ground, the tires of the tow truck are applying force into the ground, or your feet applying force into the ground, are you in that case pushing or pulling from your foot perspective or from your wheels perspective? If you think about it for a minute, you will come to the conclusion that from that perspective, you are pushing. So regardless of where you are when thinking about creating movement, it is important to find where you are pushing. And when you find where you are pushing, you'll be able to find the beginning of a progression. Now remember, we are talking about movement ability. And in this case, we're talking about movement control. Our movement control is our relationship to how we are expressing movement. When you think about pushing versus pulling, it's in pushing where we tend to naturally have better control. It's in pulling where we tend to lose control of our abilities. And this is something that as we continue to go into the different techniques, will start to make more sense. As I continue here, if anything is coming up for you, questions, concerns, whatever it may be, remember to use the chat to find some clarity here at the end. Now, here below the little image of Sticks and his buddy, Sticks 2, I guess we'll call him or her. It actually looks like the red one looks like there's some ponytails on them, but that's just the two lines expressing effort. I addressed the concept of flinching. Something that happens when we move is that we tend to flinch when we are unable to create stability from an intentional place, from a place of muscular control. And if you read through this chapter, you'll see that when performing a hollow body position and lifting our arms or shoulders off the ground, our feet off the ground, some of us, or some people, tend to find stability by breaking the general global shape. So the general global shape for a hollow body position is this concave shape. But if you look closely at the image here on the bottom left, you'll see that my lower back is slightly off the ground. That position right there, although generally speaking, is a hollow body position, the strategy for adopting that hollow body position is one that is not utilizing our muscular strength, my muscular strength in this case, to find stability. Thus, the control is going to be fragile, and I'll talk about what that means in a second. And the form, when we look closely, doesn't look and feel as good as it possibly could. Do you guys see how I'm starting to pull it back to where I started? What does this mean? This simply means that we can perform movements, techniques, methods in ways that from the outside point of view, without addressing the subjectivity within the feel of looking at something, can be considered great performance. We see this a lot in CrossFit. And where do we see it? Well, we see it especially when people are competing, and they are competing in the sport of CrossFit with very little movement practice. Something that happens in CrossFit is that they teach you how to squat, press, pull, in very simple ways that are very effective, but that are so general that they leave out the nuances that allow us to access not only great form, but the best control of that movement. When we are working on this basic standing shape that I was addressing just a little bit ago from the hollow body approach or progression, what we're really looking for is that. We're simply looking for how do I establish control at spinal level in order to create enough stability in the structures that hold my central nervous system in order for me to express myself at a higher level at the extremities, in my arms, my legs. And with that ability to express myself at the extremities, get access to better control, better technique. Now, something to keep in mind here is that if you look at the difference between the hollow body position on the top image and the hollow body position while in a prone position at the bottom, in the bottom image, the strategy that I am utilizing to find stability in both those images is the same. But in which one do you see a higher level of exaggeration in the form? In this case, the form is one that is looks like a little zigzag line. It looks a little broken, we could call it. It doesn't look very smooth. Which one do you see being more exaggerated, the top one or the bottom one? If you think it's the top one, just give me a thumbs up in the on video right now. If you think it's the bottom one, just give me a thumbs down. So which one do you see as more exaggerated in form? I think it's pretty clear that the bottom one is more exaggerated than the top one. Now, why is this? Well, when I am lying down on my back facing up, or in other words, in a supinated position, I am pushing my lower back into the ground. When I am facing down in a prone position, in order to get into a hollow body shape, into that concave shape, or in this case, a convex shape, I have to pull my spine away from the ground. Remember that I said that pushing, when it comes to progressions, comes before pulling. In the prone shape, in the bottom shape, I am pulling my spine away from the ground. And thus, what you will observe if you test this on anybody is that most people will adopt the shape that you're seeing me in right here in this image. And the reason is because their strategy for finding control is one that is hasn't been trained. In other words, in our daily practices is something that we miss in noticing, in nourishing. Why is this important? Well, because if you are going to move through space, you are going to move from a standing position to a lying down position, facing up, supinated, or facing down, prone, or upside down. And as you move from one position to another in space, the strategies that you are using to find control from a muscular perspective, meaning from a place of engagement, is going to be different. In other words, you're going to have to change how you are finding tension or letting go of tension, depending on what your orientation in space is. And two of the most basic orientations are standing up and lying down. When standing up, you can either be head up, right, or you can be inverted. When on the ground, you can be in a supinated position or in a prone position. Some of you may be thinking, well, don't you go on your side once in a while? Yes, you will. We'll get to that soon. But for now, simply notice the strategies that exist, the difference in strategies that exist depending on what position I'm in. When I'm supinated, when I'm pushing in this case, I use a slightly different strategy. When I am prone or facing down, I am pulling away from gravity, thus I'm using a different shape. Why is this important? Well, this is important because if we struggle to find strategies for control while static, meaning just holding a shape, what's going to happen when we start moving? It's going to get way more complex. And that's why when thinking about this, what we're trying to think about is what is the primer, the first step the first level of awareness that I have to find within my practice to be able to move with control, to find movement control. And this is where now in this next section, I talk about the hollow rock, which is adopting this shape, shape five, and now adding a rock, one that allows you to move forward and back, something very simple, which goes through three positions, the hollow body position, the rock where you're rocking forward, the feet come down and the shoulders and arms come up, and then the rocking backwards, which is the legs come up and the hands go down. Now, what is happening here? As we rock forward and back, you are going to be challenged at spinal level in maintaining that hollow body shape, or in other words, not deviating from that concave shape that we originally established. And in doing this, if you practice it yourself or you do it with, or you see somebody else do it, you'll notice that when they rock forward, they will start to find stability in a slightly different way than how they do it as they rock backwards. You'll see it even in their eyes. Just watch them do it in their eyes. You'll see that what they're trying to do as they're moving is slightly different in their forward rocking and in their versus their backward rocking. This difference is the difference in pushing and pulling. The rocking forward is going to be your pushing. Think about you pushing away from the upper body. That's you rocking forward. You rocking backwards is you now pulling. And where does the pull come from in the case of this hollow body position? Well, the pull comes from the hips, from the legs. I share this because as you read this this little section, these little strategies are that which we are so used to anchoring our thinking in. We anchor our thinking for establishing best form and best control in the techniques used. What we're trying to do in our thinking right now is we're trying to flip this whole thing inside out. And we're starting to think about what is happening internally versus what am I doing externally? In other words, what is the purpose? That's my external, my context versus what is it that allows me to come closer to my purpose? I know this is a lot of information and it sounds complicated, but I can tell you that once we get into the handstand push-up, I'm going to pull all these concepts back out and into the handstand push-up, and it's going to start to make sense to you. Now, I want you to just observe here for a second and remember the two positions, the hollow body facing up and the hollow body facing down or in a prone position. And I want you to now compare them to this shape, which is the plank, which is a starting position for a push-up. And I want you to see how in the two images here on the right-hand side, how the shape, I know it's very small, the shape that I'm adopting there has a more uniform shape from the perspective of the spine, so from head to hips, than the one that we're seeing in this image here at the bottom left. Can everybody see how here in my lower back there's a little kink versus here it's a little bit flatter, it's a little bit straighter? If you can see that, that's all I want you to keep in mind for now. And the way that we establish that is by working on stabilizing the hips first. And I'm sharing this concept of stabilizing the hips first because when we get into the progression principles, knowing where to start is going to be key. So I'm gonna leave that at that for now. And I'm gonna move into this next progression, which is now taking this prone position from a hollow body perspective and now taking it into extension. And extension being this little Superman position. And realizing that everything that we just talked about from the hollow body perspective can also be done from this Superman or arched position. From just establishing the two shapes in a static, from a static perspective, and then doing it with a rock. And realizing that in rocking forward and rocking back, there's going to be pushing and pulling. And the strategies for stabilizing, for controlling the movement and executing on form is going to be slightly different whether I'm pushing or whether I'm pulling. Now, if pulling in the hollow rock was lifting your legs and your hips and pushing was rocking forward, what do you think is pulling in the case of the Superman rock? And what do you think is pulling, pushing, sorry. Is going forward pushing or is going backward pushing? Is going forward pulling or is going backward pulling? What do you think? Let me know in the chat what you think. And then I'll address that at the end of today's session. If you just read the paragraph, you'll know the answer. But I'll just leave it there for now. Now, getting into this next bit of it, once we understand movement control, which comes from the central nervous system and the positions that we adopt to engage with the central nervous system, we can start to address the concept of movement strength and skill. Movement strength is our capacity to move. Our skill is our ability to apply that capacity. Why is this important? Well, as you can see, if you read the first paragraph, I ask a question, which is how strong do you need to be to perform a 500-pound squat? The answer is going to be strong enough. How strong do you need to be to perform a pistol squat? Strong enough. How strong do you need to be to do a handstand? Strong enough. So how do we find the answer to being strong enough? Well, that's where skill comes in, which is our ability to apply our capacity to move. When you think about movement through the lens of freestyle, we're thinking about shapes. When you're thinking about shapes applied to a specific context or a specific purpose, it is skill. It's the nervous system expressing itself in a very coherent, coordinated way in the body in order to achieve a specific outcome. Movement strength is the foundation. Skill is the application. If you have studied CrossFit, you've heard about the 10 different aspects of fitness, which are strength, stamina, endurance, flexibility. And then you have balance, accuracy, agility, and coordination. And those eight produce power and speed. When it comes to strength, movement strength specifically, our capacity to move, I want you to think about it from those four aspects, from the perspective of strength, stamina, endurance, and flexibility. Strength being your ability to apply force, stamina, your ability to sustain force, endurance, your ability to produce energy from a cardiovascular perspective, and this being the ability that you have to use the oxygen that you breathe, the nutrients that come from your food, and then synthesize those into ATP or energy that is going to translate into stamina and strength, and then flexibility, which is your ability to reach different ranges of motion. These four aspects are the ones that are the foundation for movement strength. So when you're thinking about creating progressions, when you're thinking about your training, if you want to improve your movement strength, if you want to address your practice from movement strength, then you're going to think about it from these four domains. Now, when you're thinking about skill, which is your ability to apply your movement strength, this is when you can now start to focus on your balance, your accuracy, your agility, your coordination. Your balance being your ability to maintain your center mass right on top of the base support. Your accuracy meaning your ability to hit one point or one form, one movement over and over again in a way that is very specific, moreover predetermined. Your agility, your ability to change directions, making things smooth. This is part of that which allows you to perform in a way that maintains form and has great control. And when you observe it, makes it look really nice. And then finally, coordination, which is your ability to create complex expressions of your movement. Now, all this is there to give you a map. And this map, kind of being presented here in the map that you can see, the little grid that you can see, the graphic that you can see here on the left-hand side. And this little grid here is something I'm going to address next week a little bit more when talking about skill transfer. But I want you to see every single point in that map as different techniques. And these techniques being that which all together composes your movement ability. And the connections between these different techniques being that which determines your skill. Don't worry, we'll get into it as we go on. But for now, we're just going to leave it at that. Now, what is this concept of skill transfer and why is it so important? Well, because skill transfer is your ability to take your strength, your capacity to move, your ability to apply that movement, and then begin to create. This is something that we see in CrossFit a lot. When we see people who are new to CrossFit and come in and tend to be quick at adapting to the program, those are the people that when you ask them, they will tell you right away what they have done in the past to develop their movement ability. And they may say something like, I did gymnastics when I was a kid, and then I got into track and field, and I was also playing soccer, and then I got into the weight room. I learned something about Olympic weightlifting and powerlifting, and I like to dance. They will tell you that they have all these different techniques under their belt. And those techniques have been developed in a way that are transferable with each other. Where their gymnastics and their weightlifting were working in sync to make both those disciplines better. This is skill transfer. And skill transfer can only be understood if we're able to take some of the concepts that we have talked about today and mix them together like ingredients that produce a meal that is not only going to taste good, but is also going to be nourishing. And these ingredients can be found in strength, stamina, endurance, flexibility, balance, coordination, agility, and accuracy when we're looking at it from the fitness perspective. And they are developed when we are able to see the different shapes, the different forms that are the most transferable forms. The ones that when we train them, give us the most amount of the biggest return. And when doing this, realizing that what it produces is that which we tend to define as performance, which is usually measured in power and speed. Now, what is all this that I'm talking about? Well, this is the language of movement. This is the core of all that which you already do as a physical being. And it's so convoluted when you break it down the way that we have here, but when studied, worked with, becomes very, very clear. We're getting here to the end of today's session, but I have a little story here that I also encourage you to read, which is when I worked with Jason Kalipa, I think it was 12 years ago now, and I suggested that I would teach him how to do a backflip, and just for the sake of it, that we would time how fast he could learn how to do a backflip on his own. And I believe he got it under 10 minutes or so. I can't remember the exact time. It was like 9 minutes and 11 seconds. And the way that I broke it down, which is something that you can actually watch on YouTube, is by addressing the technique of a backflip through movements that he was familiar with. Number one, jumping and landing. Number two, using the power developed in Olympic weightlifting to jump and land. And then for the flip itself, using a simple knees to elbows or toes to bar to help him understand the creation of the original rotation that would get him over the backflip. And then by connecting it in that way, him being able to create his own map, remember the map that I was showing you just a second ago, this one here to our left, and thus producing a high level of skill transfer. And this skill transfer is the key for developing progressions. And this is why the best progression is the progression that will not only ramp up the most novice athlete, but will also challenge the most advanced. And this is where one of the things that we're going to look for next week as we go into the handstand pushup and we really dive into this is how we can create universal prescriptions, universal movement patterns, such as the hollow body, in a way that doesn't only allow us to ramp up the most novice to get the beginner to understand, but to also, with the same technique, with the same method, challenge the most advanced. And the only way that we can do it is by understanding the complexity of that which I shared with you today. Freestyle is convoluted. Freestyle is chaotic. Freestyle is complex. But the understanding of it is simple, simple, simple. And that's what we're trying to peel back on right now. So if you feel a little overwhelmed right now, or you are uncertain of what we're even talking about, don't try to control it. Just allow it to be what it is. And go back and read these chapters and see what comes up for you next week. So with that being said, I'm going to stop the sharing and I'm going to go into taking questions now. I know some of you may have to go as it is already, it's already been almost an hour. For those of you who are staying, feel free to drop comments in the chat or unmute yourself to ask a question. For those of you who have to leave, know that this will be recorded and posted in the group as soon as we're done. Let me start with Campbell's question, which I don't think was a full question yet, which was around the difference of coaching and writing progressions from the perspective of the start, transition, finish, and shift, connect, flow. Campbell, if you have a very specific example of what you've tried to do, whether it's creating a progression for a squat or a handstand or a muscle up or in weightlifting, feel free to write that or unmute yourself and maybe we can talk about it a little bit.
Yeah, I guess my question would be, when is it more appropriate to use each perspective? Like if we take the squat example, it almost seems more like I would address the start, transition, finish with a beginner, like adding an isometric pause or an eccentric for some control. And then sometimes you might look at a more advanced squatter and something seems a little bit off. Maybe there's like a little bit of cave, but you can't quite tell what it is. I guess it's less of a specific question and more, when is it appropriate and how could I best utilize the shift, connect, flow?
Well, it's always appropriate. That's the first answer. And you can go in whatever order you want. If we had to create a structure and I had to tell you what the hierarchy is, I would say start with the start, transition, finish, which is very general. It's saying, this is the position I'm going to start in. This is what I'm going to transition through. And this is how I'm going to finish. That's purely mechanical. And then you can take the shift, connect, flow as the second layer that you add into the progression, because that one has more to do with control. And think about flow as your ability to control a form, to control a movement. So shift, connect, flow, which is our ability to shift our center of mass in relationship to our base support, connect changing points of contact, which we're going to talk about next week about what that means in terms of creating stability. And then flow being the seamlessness, the efficiency, the effectiveness, the beauty of the expression. So that becomes layer two. So my suggestion would be take any progression that you're creating, take any coaching roadmap that you're creating, and start with the first framework, start, transition, finish, and then add the shift, connect, flow. And then see if you can braid them, not necessarily in the steps, but in how you communicate. And something that you're going to become, and this is not just you, Campbell, it's me and every single person that's here. One thing that you're going to realize is that what we're doing here is we're not trying to become experts in biomechanics or in movement. We're trying to become experts in how we communicate movement. And and becoming experts in how we communicate movement that's the process of mastery, because you never arrive at being an expert.
That makes sense. And then what you just said helped put it in perspective for me. So flow, I mean, all these things are found through repetition, but like flow especially seems like it's found through repetition of movement.
That's correct. Correct. And that's where you're priming the nervous system. You're doing it over and over again until it becomes second nature. You don't have to think about it. The body does it, so to speak. It's ingrained in that pattern. That pattern is ingrained in your nervous system, rather. And then that's when you can add a layer to it. You can polish the form, which is the beauty of it. And actually, this leads to the second question that's here. And if you have more to add to this, Campbell, feel free. But I thought I would share another question that's coming in, which is that, and it says in Spanish here, but I'm just going to translate it, is that the question is, can movements be taken to the perspective of pushing before pulling? And if so, if we apply this to a ring row, is it pushing the elbows behind your back where the pull occurs? And the answer is yes. The goal here is to not think about pushing and pulling movements, but rather trying to find where we are pushing, where within a movement one is pushing. So for example, if you're performing a squat, you may be thinking about pushing away from the ground as you're coming out of the squat. You're pushing away from the bottom position. But as you're going into the squat, are you pushing then? And if so, where are you pushing? This is something to start to think about. And if you start to think about this, you realize that, oh, wait, my eccentric movement, my negative movement, my descent, although it is a pull from a mechanical perspective, what I'm actually doing is gently resisting gravity and pushing against it in order to control the movement. The eccentric phase, the negative phase of a squat, can be seen as a push, where the push, in terms of application of force, is just less than gravity and thus allowing us to pull. Can we see that, or is that too far out there right now? If not, you can take the question. Yeah, great. Melissa, you can see that. Go ahead.
I do. And just maybe just like for the group, because I come from like the stability background. So this, my internet was in and out the whole time. So I apologize for that. But yeah, totally where your body interfaces with the implement or with the floor, and bringing your awareness to that can, especially among the initiation stages, like you were talking about, like that flinch stage, if I understood you correctly, that's really where your stabilizing strategy, like really presents itself. And that sometimes people get, I think they want to create the image of the movement in their mind, and then they lose connection with where their body is specifically interfacing with the implement or the floor. And then to bring the awareness back to that is how you create better stability amongst a beginner. So, yeah, I really love how you connected like the push as like the simplest phase. That was a framework that I hadn't considered before, especially in the stability world.
There it is. Yeah, that's well said. And an example here would be if we take the standing position and then we apply the standing position to running, that ability to stack the spine, for example, while running and taking impact and having a moment where neither of our feet are in contact with the ground, the strategy for stabilizing for some people may be in going into full extension at the level of the lumbar spine and thus being stable, having decent form, you can just call it form in that case, that is allowing you to move, but over time being detrimental to your body. And this is why we see a lot of runners that end up having to have some kind of surgery or develop some kind of disc problem, herniations. So our strategy for stabilizing our spine, for example, is the first layer of understanding mechanical stability for maximum efficiency in the way that we utilize our nervous system. And all of this being practiced in these very, very simple movement expressions, such as a hollow body position or standing tall and adopting an anatomical position. The beauty of training, which is cool, is that training is an exaggeration of reality. That's what we're really trying to do in our training. We're just trying to exaggerate our reality so we can become more aware of that which is happening to our body and our relationship to it. Now trying to bring it back to pushing and pulling, Melissa said that in the Superman rock, the forward rock is pushing and the backward rock is pulling. Yes, that is correct. And we can address next week why that is correct. But if you just think about it from a movement perspective, when you're moving down towards the ground and your legs are coming up behind you, you are pushing with your upper body. Your lower body may be pulling, but where your awareness is, your immediate awareness of what you're seeing is in the upper body. And as you're rocking back and you're having to lift your chest up, think about pulling away from the ground. And in those, that pushing and pulling behavior, finding stability at spinal level. Phil says, I think it's just inverted. So the opposite. Okay. So yeah, you were referring to the Superman rock. Were you correct or were you wrong? We'll address that next week. You'll see when we dive into it a little bit more. How everybody is right and everybody is wrong, it depends on where you're looking. Okay, Campbell says, I would also say in the ring, row, or pull-up, you can create more force and control through pushing down on the rings or bar. Yes, I think that's exactly right. You can establish a way of creating more control when you are able to see where you're pushing. So for example, if you're grabbing the bar, pushing against the bar is actually pulling. Pushing the elbows down is actually a pulling motion. And this is where it's important to distinguish application of force, hand grabbing a bar, and then you pushing down, that being the application of force, from the mechanical expression of pushing and pulling, which remember, pushing is away from the midline and pulling is towards the midline. A lot of concepts floating right now, but worry not, as they will all kind of come together as we go. Did anybody have any other questions from last week or anything that came up this week that they feel like they would like to address right now? If so, feel free to unmute yourself and ask. If no, I will bring this to a gentle close.
Carl, can I ask a quick question?
Yeah, please.
Where does intra-abdominal pressure and the regulation of that interface with freestyle? Because in listening you to describe stability, I heard a lot about like the connective tissue, bones, ligaments, tendons, then also like the neuromuscular system around that. But just like kind of going into like when I work with athletes, you can have someone in, you know, a perfectly neutral position, right? Stacked correctly, like engaged, and yet they're mismanaging intra-abdominal pressure in a way that over time will create injury, like mm-hmm. in a bearing down situation or in like a pushing forward situation. And so where does that fit into freestyle?
Well, it's a big question because we could go for 2 hours just talking about this, but let's just try to play it this way. What's your framework for thinking about stability from that perspective, from creating inter-abdominal pressure?
So I was formerly trained in dynamic neuromuscular stabilization, which says that, you know, your core is a canister from like skull all the way into pelvis, and it functions as a system. And that the best way to protect the spine is to, of course, like maintain that neutrality and to have the entire abdominal wall, diaphragm, pelvic floor, like everything supporting the spine to be working in synergy. Which also means that when it comes to intra-abdominal pressure, that there's essentially like this 360 degrees, so equal amounts forces. I would say, especially for CrossFitters, it's getting into like the lateral and posterior abdominal wall that becomes challenging because there's a lot of posterior chain dominance. So like a lot of extension in the back, where you've got like a little bit more of like bone on bone stability, which means that a lot of intra-abdominal pressure goes forward or down. So we end up seeing in high level, you know, CrossFitters specifically, gaping diastasis from people who've never had children, or pelvic floor dysfunction, like peeing during heavy squats, or, you know, releasing gas, or I think some people talk about like a shard away from a PR sort of a thing, but it's all referring to this same concept that, you know, stability comes from somewhere. And I think if we're, so like what I would see is like intra-abdominal pressure coming into like your straight stick figure, like mm-hmm. it's still being preliminary to getting into like hollow body, arch body positions. Yeah, sorry. I guess that was a long answer to what's my framework.
Yeah, it's a long framework, which is why we're having this discussion. Is everything that you have learned and know has a place in looking at movement. And the goal here is to think about how are the different strategies and concepts that you have developed in your training relate to creating the most simple yet effective progressions, movement progressions. So for example, if we take the standing position, what would be two or three cues that you would give somebody from a general perspective on creating the right form, posture, to have control in whatever they're doing, whether it's standing or about to start walking or running or jumping or going under load, that would be helpful in this case? What would from your perspective be two or three cues that gives you the access to best form and control?
I guess this is where that feels like standing actually feels like an advanced progression from my perspective, that it's mm-hmm. actually supine and prone, where the floor is holding your spine in neutral. And now you can like kind of drop one thing off your radar to be worrying about and focus on the harder things, which for a lot of people is like activation of like, you know, the back and side body, and also like where bringing their awareness to where their pressure goes, and then coming upright. And now we do have some load of the body. Mm-hmm. That would be like, you know, progression number two.
Yeah, no, that's perfect. So I, first of all, that kind of relates to a little bit of what we talked about today. We talked about the hollow body position or lying down on the ground being a great place to start to challenge that which we see, for example, in a standing position. So that I totally hear, totally relates. But what I'm asking you is not necessarily a progression for loading, let's say, the system, but rather for creating the best awareness or the what are the strategies, the cues that give you the strategies for having the stability needed to not only be lying down and to do something from there or standing?
I guess this is why I'm here, right?
Yeah. And these are the questions that are so important, but this is great. Let's just explore it for a minute or two if people can stick around here. So when lying down and you teaching somebody for the first time about this, what is the one, two, or three things that you tell them? Like just cliff notes here.
So I typically give some tactile stimulation because giving it, like verbal cues from this perspective are only so efficient. Tactile is actually like where it's the most helpful. So I would either have them lay on something or use their hands around their low ribs to go around the sides and the back, and then to not have them force their breath, but try to like allow their breath to expand their hands, and like even like give your like rub the side body, like wake up the neurons that are there and like reconnect it to your brain and just breathe and expand there and just practice that. That's like my first. And again, it's not short and simple.
that's fine. So let's peel back even further. What's the outcome that you want to see?
So I want to see like this 360 degree expansion of their abdominal wall.
Yeah, expansion of the abdominal wall, which basically when you have that expansion, you're creating some tension. That tension is going to be enough to hold the spine in a neutral position and thus having a good starting ground. Something that if just being there for eternity, it will be safe. Is that correct?
Yes.
Great. And then in the expansion of the abdominal wall, in order to maintain a neutral shape of the spine, which gives you access to the central nervous system and thus keeps it safe, and also potentially you can move from there. Where are the places that you've seen the most amount of weakness in people or the most amount of unawareness around this basic outcome that you're looking for?
If you're asking for like common faults?
Yeah, common faults. Just give me one or two.
So I see their belly pushing like up forward. So like this anterior posterior breathing, or I see a lot of chest breathing. So actually there's no movement like around their diaphragm. They're essentially picking up their chest to basically change the position of their diaphragm to get a breath.
Mm-hmm. So as the diaphragm, as you breathe in and that diaphragm goes down, the expansion of through the back tends to be the weakest area of understanding. Is that right? Accurate? Am I hearing that correctly?
Yes. Yep.
Great. So the first thing that you do is you try to give them awareness by touching them maybe in that area and say, hey, try to push against this area right here. So it's not just you expanding on this side, you're also expanding on this side, and thus you're creating this cylinder. Is that accurate? Right.
Yes.
Great. Fantastic. See, so now we're starting to work with it. So now when you're thinking about that, what is it you're really thinking about? You're thinking about taking a section of the body, which let's say it goes from the chest down to the hips, and you're thinking about it being in the shape of a cylinder, and that cylinder pushing, distributing, it's expanding as evenly as possible, which we know is not possible to do, but as evenly as possible in all directions in a 360 degree motion. And keep in mind that there are anatomically, you can't expand your back as much as you can your belly. You just can't. So in some way, explaining to people that just a little bit of pressure towards the back will give them a new level of stability that will produce a form that is more neutral, that is not into more extension, but more neutral, and thus more applicable, more transferable into everything else.
Right.
Are you with me there? So yes. What we're addressing is, first we're addressing form. What is the form? It's the cylinder. Second, we're addressing pushing versus pulling. the expansion, and then we're addressing how that would potentially transfer. And then we're saying from a mechanical perspective, we're saying, hey, let's start you on the ground in a supinated position where you're going to be pushing your lower back maybe into the ground. Let me help you feel that. And then we're going to see if you can translate that into a standing position where now you don't have access to the ground. Thus, you have to imagine the ground, and thus your proprioception has to be greater. Your awareness of movement has to be greater.
Yeah.
Did I say that in a way that makes sense to you and is in alignment with what you know and what you do?
Yeah. Yeah, definitely.
That is exactly what we talked about today. So I used everything that we did today and I just reflected it on to you in alignment with that which you do. That's freestyle. That's the ability to create these progressions, but it only happens in communication. We're simply observing, describing, and then communicating through progression. Mm-hmm. And the beauty of this is that we can be wrong every single time in a way that is actually safe. It's wrong in a way where you're correct, meaning that you will always be able to see what regression do I need in order to progress.
Thanks for that. I really appreciate the extra time and deep dive.
Of course. Thank you. It was a great question. Was that helpful or to everybody else here? Were you able to follow along there? If not, this is where the work starts. You have to start where your knowledge lies. Start with what you know. Start with what you believe to be true. And then from there, see if you can take every concept that we go through or as you read the book and see if you can apply it. And then notice the natural hierarchy that comes from it. And that natural hierarchy not being one that tells you the steps to follow, but rather how to understand, to get a fuller picture of what is happening. A progression is not necessarily about the steps to follow, but rather the understanding, and thus allowing you to count in a way that may seem out of order, but producing the best results. This is the biggest limiter that we see in gymnastics, is that in gymnastics, for example, you have levels. You go through 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, all the way up to 10. But sometimes it's okay to start at level 8, work your way back to 1, then jump to 6, then come to 3, then 2, and then up to 10. You can go in that order if you have an understanding of why you're doing what you're doing. Okay. Any other questions, my friends? Okay. Allow the complexity and how convoluted this conversation is and how crazy it is to dive into reading this chapter for next week and then simply allowing yourself to go through these sessions and putting these concepts into play in your conversations and then noticing how little or how much you know about the topic. And then allowing that experience to bring the question that you need to ask forward. And through those questions, we're going to get so much more out of these sessions. I'm thinking that maybe 10 minutes of Q&A is going to be too much. So maybe too little time. So what I'm thinking is if you guys are okay with this as we are freestyling, is how about we do this? Going forward, let's make these sessions 90 minutes, but let's finish at the hour. Anybody who wants to leave a comment or a question can leave that in the chat. If you want to stick around for the Q&A, I'll add that as an extra 30 minutes at the end. And that way, those who leave will be able to watch the recording, and that will give us more time to dive in and still be able to cover the material. Does that sound like a plan? Because I'm starting to realize that the questions may require us to go a little bit deeper and to give it a little bit more time. So if you're okay with it, I'm going to shift this into 90-minute sessions, but I'm going to keep it at 1 hour for the chapter reading, so to speak. Which by now you all know that this is no reading when we do these sessions. It's me jumping back and forth from different concepts to try to paint a picture. Yeah, cool. Just give me a thumbs up if you're cool with that. If you're not cool with that, just give me a thumbs down, and that's fine too. We'll work with it. Much love, everybody. Thank you for being here. I'll have the recording up later today. And as you go through the chapter, if something comes up for you, you can leave a comment in the group and we can have a little chat going on there. And all questions like the ones that Campbell asked and Leonel was asking and Melissa were asking, all of this is what's going to guide us to get a better understanding of the material. So with that being said, thank you for being here. And yeah, I'll see you next week. Bye, everybody.